It's been four long years since four people went out for a day of fun with their families at Dreamworld, and they never came home. Today, the theme park's parent company, Ardent Leisure, has been convicted of three criminal charges and fined millions of dollars as the families of the victims relived that horrifying day once again. Shannon Marshall McCormack was in court for the sentencing.
$3.6 million. That is the fine Dreamworld has been slugged after it was found it failed to safely operate its Thunder River Rapids ride back in October 2016, killing four people. Cindy Lowe, Kate Goodchild, Luke Dorset and Ruzi Aragi died when they were thrown from a raft into the conveyor belt below. The prosecutor slammed Ardent Leisure over its repeated failures to listen to several safety audits, which recommended a suite of safety measures be installed, an emergency stop button that would have stopped the ride in 2 seconds instead of eight, a water level sensor that would have immediately stopped the ride as well when the pump failed, and it ultimately did on that day, as well as creating a faster and simpler shutdown procedure if there were an accident. Now, the magistrate also, in sentencing Ardent Leisure, highlighted that if any of these safety measures were implemented, it would have likely prevented the incident altogether, and it could have done so for a relatively cheap price.
Ardent accepts responsibility for this tragedy and fully accepts the court's decision.
Family members either listened to today's proceedings via video link or in court. Kim Dorset and her granddaughter Ebony Turner turned up to listen to today's sentencing. Kim Dorset read a victim impact statement out in court saying, "I cry for my children, my lost children, every day. A broken heart has no words." But she didn't answer questions on the way out.
Is it a tough day ahead for you?
Absolutely. Like every day.
Dreamworld's executives have unreservedly apologised for the incident, say they have learned from it, implementing a suite of safety measures. They have 1 month to pay the $3.6 million fine.
He boarded the Manly ferry and never came home. Now a fresh appeal has been launched to find Kenneth Haynes. The 73-year-old was last seen in person at a home in Acacia Gardens in the city's west last Tuesday. He was captured on security cameras catching public transport later that same day. Nine News has spoken to his family. We'll hear from them a little later in the bulletin. Well, millions of dollars will be injected into airlines as the government works to keep planes in the skies in a bid to boost tourism. Political reporter Jonathan Kersley joins us now from Canberra. Jonathan, closed borders are once again an issue.
That's right, Mark. Again, the government is now working on a road out of this crisis. And while JobKeeper has been extended but scaled back from today, subsidies for domestic airlines will continue until January into March for regional airlines. The subsidy started around about 5 months ago and has so far cost the taxpayers more than $150 million. We know the tourism industry was among the first and hardest hit by the coronavirus pandemic and the crisis which has followed. And the government continues to push its case for internal borders to be reopened right across the country to allow Australians to travel more at home. There is some concern, though, that New Zealanders could be able to travel to some parts of Australia before other Australians can. Here's the Deputy Prime Minister, Michael McCormack.
I urge and encourage, even implore, those premiers to revisit their closures of their borders, because by closing their borders, it's meaning that interstate travel can't happen as it should be.
Are you saying the border restrictions are more political than health-based at the moment?
That would be right. I think they have been all along.
And, Mark, a little more than a week out from the federal budget, the deficit tipped to be over $200 billion. Respected economist Chris Richardson said the budget is bent, but it is not broken. A report out today from Deloitte Access Economics states future deficits are not as likely to be as scary as many would expect, and says while 2020 has been a war to protect the health of Australians, the next war is going to be a war for jobs.
Probably going to be a series of more one-size-fits-all measures, different subsidies. Yes, maybe a bit of picking winners around specific areas in manufacturing, but the broader story will be more broad measures.
Many small businesses and businesses of all sizes are still struggling, and we need to make sure that support is flowing.
And Mark, jobs is how the federal government is going to frame this budget to be handed down next Tuesday. Bringing forward tax cuts is likely, but the big question is, how will the government create jobs in an economy that has already been hit so hard by restrictions which have been imposed to protect against a virus? A key stop on that road will be manufacturing. The Prime Minister will have more to say on that later this week, Mark.
Jonathan Kersley in Canberra for us. Thank you. The man who is suspected of fatally shooting New Zealand-born police officer in London has been named as 23-year-old Lewis De Zoysa. The handcuffed man opened fire on Sergeant Matt Ratana before shooting and injuring himself on Saturday. Sergeant Ratana was 2 months away from retiring. The suspect remains in hospital in a critical condition. Around 50 people have been evacuated from their apartments in Sydney's West overnight after a fire broke out in the underground car park. Emergency services attended the scene at Guildford following reports of smoke billowing from two unit blocks just before midnight. Firefighters managed to extinguish the blaze. The cause is under investigation.